Love always spies.
Elvis the Porter invites Vivian Lash to join him in the private dick business. We can spy on Creepy Neighbour and catch him out when he gets up to his tricks. You'll get the full chocolate drop of the arms you miss. Elvis will see to it. Elvis isn't really a porter. He has big plans and a wardrobe full of the other Elvis's clothes, including the jumpsuit he died in, which he bought with insurance money when his mother, saddest sin it was, passed to the other side. Who sold you the suit? Elvis looks behind to check no one's eavesdropping. Elvis is sworn to secrecy, miss, but I can reveal that the king was buried in his smalls. The other Elvis's underwear probably wasn't that small, but I don't want to think about a bloated corpse's pants. I'm at Graceman's on all the big occasions, miss, like the day Elvis married Priscilla. Elvis got married in Vegas. But I don't want to spoil the fun. The king isn't dead, you know. He faked it. All you need is a body and some sellotape. The other Elvis saw him when he peeked in the kitchen window last time he went to Graceland's. Was he eating a cheeseburger? No, he was standing there all alone, miss, looking out at me. What's the sellotape for? Elvis taps his nose. Top secret, miss. We sit in the gloom of my kitchen, drinking coffee with drowning cinnamon sticks, plotting our peeping Tom larks. Is that your dad? Elvis asks, looking at the picture on the wall by the fridge. It's Stanley Kubrick.
He looks like you,
Elvis says, not wanting to lose face.
He could be your father.
Stanley looks nothing like me on account of being a fat, swarthy man and me being a thin white girl, if glimpsed quickly in moonlight. But I let it go. How many people actually look like their father anyway? And Elvis is impossible to argue with on account of him being retarded, stubborn, and unable to stop talking. Elvis gives me the white Marilyn dress, the very one she wore in the 7-year itch, according to the man in the pub who sold it to him. Change into this, miss, and you will surely be able to tempt Mr. Creepy.
To do what?
You know.
I don't, as it goes.
To do the unspeakable.
Then we can get him arrested.
Creepy has put in a written complaint about Elvis peering in his bedroom window, so it's in his interest to have him arrested again. He doesn't care whether it's for murdering his wife, raping me, or double parking outside the steam room. I will, of course, be in the bushes the entire time, with a torch, at your service, Elvis reassures me. Maybe the white dress will blow up, revealing white pants like the ones I flashed in Venice when I was 13. Elvis does the cakewalk, cementing our bargain. The dress smells of Chanel No. 5 and white trash sweat. Maybe he hired it from Angel Costumes. It's possible there never was a man, a pub or an insurance policy. He tells enough lies to confuse a priest. Everything would have been different, miss, if Elvis had married Marilyn. As I catwalk down the garden path and the itch get up, willing to make a fool of myself for art, Elvis stage whispers from his bush,
Don't worry, Mr. Creepy will get nowhere near your turnpike.
Buggery needs a beach and there are worse things than being raped. Try telling that to Olga Berger. I haven't thought about her for years. Walking up and down the path, tempting fate, reminds me of the little victim who didn't stand a chance. Nobody wanted to sit next to her in the bus. She smelled of wet pants and fear past its sell-by date. Nobody would share a room with her, so she had her own room, with one bed for her and another for opportunity.
We'll always have